go watch another sequel.
I've never heard of this one. Song of the South.
Oh, nobody wants to see that one anymore.
So, Song of the South. Yes, that film. The film that Disney wants to be forgotten and left behind in the dust because of the allegations of racism within the film, while at the same time re-releasing a cartoon of their very own mascot in blackface to home video. But here comes the question. Is Song of the South actually offensive? Given how little it's really acknowledged or talked about, it's kind of hard to tell. On one hand, there's a side that finds the film to be fine and not racist in any way. However, there's the other side that finds the film to be highly offensive and racist towards African Americans. I mean, look, there's gotta be, like, a clear answer to this question somewhere, right? Well, let's take a look at the facts of the situation and see what conclusion we can come to. Now, something I want to mention is this is going to require a lot, and I do mean a lot, of context with American history. And I feel I should stress that word as well, context. There's a context to everything, and stuff that was seen as okay back in the day, we see now as demeaning and fucked up. That doesn't necessarily mean it was okay back in the day, or even now. It's just more that no one really gave it much thought, or just thought, hey, this is part of the norm. And now, in the current day, we actually see what it was. The phrase, product of the times, comes very much greatly to mind when it comes to talking about these sorts of things. But before we can begin this tale of controversy and historical revisionism, I need to introduce you all to a little book from 1852. So, to start this out, we have a little book by the name of Uncle Tom's Cabin. It was published in 1852 by a woman by the name of Harriet Beecher Stowe. The main theme of the book was meant to show the true horrors and genuine evils of slavery to white audiences, while also writing in other themes, namely of family, motherhood, separation, and Christianity. She specifically writes with how Christianity is incompatible with slavery and that the title character of the book, Uncle Tom, is meant to be a Christ figure. Stowe's inspiration from the book came from a multitude of different sources. The main one, though, was the Fugitive Slave Act of 1850. This was a law that forced law enforcement to help in the return of escaped slaves in the northern states, or else face heavy fines. The law also stripped black people of their right to serve on a jury, as well as testifying on their own behalf within a court of law. And finally, a $1,000 fine and 6 months prison time for anyone harboring an escaped slave. For reference, $1,000 back then would be approximately be $31,912.89 in today's current money. So, it's quite understandable that someone would be legitimately aggravated, or dare I say, even pissed off at this, especially for someone who was pro-abolitionist like Stowe. When she released her novel, it was pretty controversial, mainly in the American South, where, surprise, surprise, there were a lot of slave owners that weren't happy with the fact that she said that slavery was bad or inhumane. In fact, she got plenty of mailed-in death threats as well, specifically one package having the severed ear of a slave. Now, there were some criticisms of the novel being inaccurate to the region, and that Stowe had never visited a plantation. Stowe, in reality, had actually spoken with a number of different runaway slaves, with the title character of Uncle Tom himself being partially based on the autobiography of former slave Josiah Henson, whose own preaching of Christianity and nonviolence was integrated into the story and into the character of Tom himself. The book itself has actually been cited as a pretty big step in not just laying the groundwork of the American Civil War, but also the abolishment of slavery that followed it in the United States as a whole. However, the book, and specifically its title character, are much more controversial. especially in later years. As to why? Well, I'll explain a little bit. So, in the book, if you can't figure it out, Tom is a slave, and specifically a Christ-like slave. And in the end, much like Jesus did, he gives his life to save those who escape from slavery. He was specifically meant to be a rejection of minstrel shows in the way he was written, and meant to humanize the pain of slavery to white audiences and truly show how barbaric it was. He was generally passive in showing kindness, akin to something like the gentle giant archetype, and is tragically killed by a white slave owner because he refused to tell the whereabouts of two escaped slaves. Although, earlier in the book, he did obey when ordered to beat other slaves, ultimately in the end, he sacrificed himself to save those from the pain that he in some part caused, and he also endured. Now, as I've said, the book itself has had some mixed responses over the years. One particular claim is that it promoted several different black stereotypes, most notably the mammy archetype, and several authors over the years have had mixed opinions on it depending on who you're asking. Some, like George Orwell, had a very mixed opinion of the book, others, like James Baldwin, had a very negative opinion on it, while some had an extremely positive opinion on it, like Selma Northup. In fact, a year after Uncle Tom's Cabin was released, Northup released his own memoirs about being a slave, 12 Years a Slave in 1853. In it, he specifically dedicated to style, and it in turn became a financial success. But Tom, as a character, did not become controversial solely from the book. If he was, then that would make this less complicated and messy. But in reality, one could argue that the reason why the character and the whole name, and even the book, Uncle Tom's Cabin, is so controversial was less from the actual book itself, and more having to do with the later stage adaptations of the play. So, you remember how I mentioned how the character of Tom was specifically written to be the antithesis to minstrel shows prevalent at the time, as well as, well, let's face it, prevalent for many decades to come? Well, I hate to break it to you, but guess what kind of shows Uncle Tom's Cabin got? So, before the year 1856, copyright in the United States was just not a thing. It was a free-for-all, pretty much. You could make any media or art form with any property and just face no repercussions for it. And at first when I heard this, personally, it sounded beautiful, magical even. But then I remembered that copyright was originally used and created for the sole purpose of protecting the artist and their work versus being a tool by the mega-rich to bully smaller artists. And in this situation, it shows why it's very, very, very necessary. And one of the things that a lot of people did before the invention of copyright was create several different stage plays and shows of Uncle Tom's Cabin. And, Stowe herself did not have any involvement with these. No royalties or payments, and especially no control over these shows or approval of them in the slightest, God no. So, you may ask, well, what did these shows do? Well, they retold the story with actors in blackface and turned Tom from a Christian martyr, an anti-slavery savior, to an old apologetic pro-slavery fool. What the fuck? Oh boy, holy shit. Reading this, I am reminded of a similar situation of something being created for something else, and then some dickhead in history coming along and completely reverting that. That being the swastika. Now, if you're not familiar, the swastika was originally a symbol of peace in the Hindu religion. And then Hitler came along and turned it into a symbol of racism and genocide. Actually, as I record this, I realize that both situations are actually pretty similar to each other, in the fact that these were once symbols meant to unify and show people peace, and specifically with Uncle Tom's Cabin, meant to show the genuine horrors and barbarism of slavery in and of itself, and promote tolerance. It later on, both of them got twisted into, well, being pro-racism, got twisted into promoting different racist ideas and philosophies. It they became the very thing that they were meant to be against, which is war and racism. It's kind of tragic to think about it, actually. And the effects of both have a long-lasting impact still, even to this very day. This image of Uncle Tom over the years, this pro-slavery old fool Tom, has become so prominent over the years, and it overrid the original intention of Stiles' character that it, well, essentially became the modern image of not just the character of Uncle Tom himself, but also the entire book. And something I want you to keep in mind, right? These minstrel shows of Uncle Tom kept going on until about the 1950s. This went on for close to 100 years or so from when the book was first published. And that, give or take specifics. I mean, hell, it could have gone on much longer than the 50s. I mean, that's just an estimate. I mean, like, keep in mind, NBC had an entire television show called The Black Minstrel Show from the 1960s or so. And not to mention, there are accounts of minstrel shows even continuing on into the early to mid-70s. So it's not necessarily just a thing of the past or just a couple incidents early on that affected it. No, this is something that went on for years and years. And any, like, intent, any of the original intent that Stahl had with the book or any historical significance that it had with starting the American Civil War and also the abolishment of slavery in the United States, that legacy has been tarnished by a bunch of racists because they took the character and twisted it and transformed it into something that it wasn't supposed to be at all. And this image is where the whole term Uncle Tom, or just Tom, comes from. Now, you could argue that it's meant to be a slur in some ways. I mean, it is listed on Wikipedia as a racial epithet, so have it as you will. I think the best way to think of, you know, when you call someone an Uncle Tom, is the best way to think of it is essentially Stockholm Syndrome for slavery and racism in this case. You know, being subservient and believing you're lower than others because of your race. A real-world example would be actual slaves. See, when slavery was abolished in the U.S., not every slave ran off, and not every slave stayed by choice. I mean, yeah, technically they were free in that they weren't technically slaves anymore, but there was no infrastructure for them, no real doctrine of equality. There was so much hardship and oppression that they still faced. You know, just because they weren't technically slaves anymore doesn't mean that they had life any easier. God, no. No, they had it hard. Hard for fucking another 100 years or so. Even today, they still had it horrible. They were still oppressed, and with no real plan or infrastructure or way to actually, like, integrate them into society as equal citizens. I mean, that mainly came from a certain someone shooting the president, and then a certain someone getting into power and fucking it all up. But, you know, because of that, because of no real infrastructure, no real nowhere to go, some just stayed because they had no other choice. In fact, in one interview from the 1930s or 40s, they had a bunch of interviews with former slaves, which is, I gotta say personally, which was fascinating to read on and listen to, because I didn't think in a million years we'd actually have audio evidence of this. But I'm glad we do. It's legitimately amazing. But anyways, in regards to this, a slave said in her own words,
"I don't hide the other side of the folks, you know, freedom. We didn't know. They just thought, you know, just feeding us, you know. Some of them didn't know where to go, you see, after freedom, bro. Just like he turned something out, you know. Didn't know where to go. But this way to stay.
And that's actually where the term Uncle Tom came from. It came from real-life slaves and the bastardization of Uncle Tom's Cabin being turned from an anti-slavery novel into a pro-slavery and racist mess. Modern usage of the term Uncle Tom, however, is kind of meshed with the whole idea about being a race traitor and, you know, acting white, acting black, and identity politics kind of horseshit. I mean, granted, there are actual cases of it, I would argue.
But it's also the bigotry of identity politics has kind of meshed it into something incomprehensible and frustrating to understand without getting a headache. You know, it's like regular politics. You try to understand it, and you're left with a fucking throbbing migraine. It hurts. The point being is this. Uncle Tom's Cabin went from an anti-slavery, pro-abolitionist novel that actually managed to elevate and help inspire former slaves to write their own memoirs into a racist caricature that destroyed and undermined the original intent of the book for generations to come. But wait, what does this have to do with Song of the South? Well, it's the knowledge of some of the terminology you'll see, but it's also this. The smallest change in history can warp the impact of and legacy of something forever within history. Things meant to be one thing can be seen as another thing due to factors out of its control. But don't you worry, though. We're getting to it. But I'm going to have to add a little bit more history because you're going to need it. So, later on, in 1862, a 14-year-old boy by the name of Joel Chandler Harris had quit school to find work in Eatonton, I think that's how you say it, Georgia. A year into the Civil War at this point, he was hired to work on a plantation as a newspaper boy. During his off time, he spent his time with the slaves on the plantation and grown very close to them. He felt a little less self-conscious around them about his Irish heritage and him being an illegitimate child of Irish immigrants around them. He felt he understood the pains of the slaves due to the relentless mockery and bullying as a child for his Irish heritage. Now, granted, he was comparing himself to literal slaves, which is like comparing breaking your arm to someone who lost their limb completely, but nonetheless, he felt empathy towards the slaves and had grown extremely close with them.
He had heard the folklore and fables that had their roots from all around Africa. Mainly one who was a hare because of the prominence of the African savanna hare, which is found all over sub-Saharan Africa. Essentially, the tales that were told were trickster ones, and the character was seen as a trickster figure, outsmarting his way out of tricky situations. And in some versions of the stories, depending on the region, the character was instead Anansi, the spider. A very popular figure in African folklore, although Anansi himself actually did encounter a tricky rabbit in some stories by the name of Adanko. Adanko? I'm hoping I'm saying Adanko, which is correct, which it translates to from Asante Twi, again, hoping I didn't butcher that, to English as hare. Yeah, that's just his name, hare. Yeah, fair enough. I mean, we have stories like Beauty and the Beast where Belle is essentially French for beauty, so. The American incarnation of the character, named br'erbear, seemed to have taken on a whole different meaning. Some scholars over the years have pointed out that this version of the character may have been a metaphor for the enslaved Africans, who used their wits to overcome and foil their foes, which in this case would be the evil white slave owners. However, something to note about br'erbear is that he was a pretty multi-dimensional character, and he was pretty amoral sometimes, and wasn't always exactly seen in the best light. He's an example of what to do and what not to do. He can be summed up pretty easily with an old African proverb, which is, "It's trouble that makes the monkey chew on hot peppers," which is essentially, extreme measures sometimes must be used in extreme circumstances. In fact, there are some that theorize that br'erbear may have actually been an inspiration for Bugs Bunny in some aspects. And while Bugs specifically was based on comedians of the day like Groucho Marx, or actors of the day like Clark Gable, some of the directors for the cartoons, like Chuck Jones for example, were pretty literate, and him specifically, spending his entire childhood reading plenty of books. Not to mention both Bugs and br'erbear rely on cunning ideas and outsmarting their foes rather than brute physical strength. I mean, it's not necessarily confirmed, but it's a possibility, and I kind of like to imagine it was at least somewhat of an inspiration. One of the most famous br'erbear stories is br'erbear and the Tar Baby. It's famous for the lesson, but also really infamous due to the name in recent years. So, the story goes out like this. Br'erfox constructs a doll made of tar and dresses it in clothes, referring to it as a tar baby. Br'erbear says hi to the doll, thinking it's a real person.
and is offended by what he perceives to be the doll's rudeness in not saying hi back. So, like any normal person would, he proceeds to beat the shit out of it and fight it, and gets stuck within Tar, and the more he struggles to get out of Tar, the more stuck he becomes. The br'er rabbit stuck in the tar, br'er fox ponders on what to do with him specifically, thinking of all sorts of ways to kill him. This gives br'er rabbit plenty of time to come up with a plan, saying, and I quote, "Do anything you want with me. Roast me, hang me, skin me, drown me, but please, br'er fox, don't fling me in the briar patch." br'er fox's sadistic nature decides to do specifically just that, thinking it'll be the most painful death for him. Of course, given rabbits tend to thrive in thickets and bushes, he manages to escape. The reason why it's become so infamous over the years is because of the term tarbeam. Originally the term meant to be stuck in a situation that becomes worse the more you struggle with it, you know, as Br'er Rabbit did while stuck in the tar. However, in recent years, the term tar baby has seen as a slur towards black Americans, and specifically black American children, and politicians that have used the term have been criticized for it. It's kind of similar to the word pickaninny, which is derived from a word used by the people of the West Indies to describe small children that became a slur towards black children here in the United States because of a fucking course, a word that didn't mean anything racist becomes racist once it comes to the U.S. Beautiful. But in places like Papua New Guinea, it still retains the original meaning rather than the racist Americanized meaning of it. So it's kind of dependent on where it is, I suppose. There's different variations of the stories depending on the region with the tar baby. Sometimes it has gifts, like a bottle of whiskey, cake, or cards to entice Br'er Rabbit, while others is just replaced by a gum doll with a plate of yams, like in a West African variation of the story. Now, you may be wondering, wait, why are they called Br'er Rabbit and Br'er Fox? What does that mean? Well, Br'er is meant to be something as a surname, short for brother, and in some adaptations, like in Song of the South, they sometimes just straight up call each other Br'er Fox or Br'er Bear. Or at least that's what it sounds like to me. I have the hearing of a 96-year-old deaf man who's gotten fucked in the ear while in prison, but you never know. The stories had Br'er Rabbit, his family, his antagonists, and their families, because everyone in these stories, they may be pulling tail, but they don't know how to pull out. But anyways, of these included Br'er Fox, his most common foil, Br'er Wolf, the second most common, Br'er Bear, who appeared less frequently in the stories, but appeared a bit more common in other adaptations, Br'er Turkey Buzzard, and a human called Mr. Man, because I guess Br'er Man was a bit too weird sounding. Chandler was inspired by these stories and decided to write them based on the slaves that had told them these stories. The various slaves that Harris had known and had grown close to had been amalgamated into a single narrator for these collections of stories, a fictional former slave known as Uncle Remus. The collection of these stories were released between the years 1881 and 1907, with the following three books after Chandler's death. They were a huge commercial success, but over the years have found some of the same controversies as Uncle Tom's Cabin has. Both share a similar controversy in that Harris wanted to give Remus an authentic voice for the books, so he wrote them with a heavy southern dialect, meant to give authenticity and as a tribute to the slaves that he actually had known. But some over the years have had problems with this, criticizing Harris for being a white guy trying to speak in the mannerisms of a black narrator. And that controversy would be carried over to the most famous film adaptations of these stories. And you know, I feel it's important to say that this wasn't meant to be something like a minstrel show. You know, it wasn't meant to be like, "Ha ha, look at them there,
nigger.
Don't they talk funny?" It was meant to be a tribute and give authenticity to the reader that they were actually reading the stories from a former slave, which, I mean, technically they were in some aspects, since it was based on real-life slaves telling these stories. Plus, you know, both Harris and Stow had spent former times with slaves and had talked with them about their experiences and these stories. Now, these stories were a huge success, although it technically wasn't their first publication. Earlier, a man had also sat down and talked with enslaved Africans, collecting their stories and their folklore, only to fall flat when they were published in a magazine called Harper's Magazine. The man was Robert Roosevelt,
uncle of President Theodore Roosevelt, one of my personal favorite presidents and one of the only few that I actually admire. Teddy was such a big fan of these stories that he actually invited Harris to the White House during his presidency, and he was incredibly shy and sheepish. Harris was a progressive and pro-abolishment, and was in favor of the New South, which stressed regional and racial reconciliation after the Reconstruction era. The Reconstruction era is a whole can of worms itself in terms of history and everything else, but I'll try to sum up points as best as I can. It was a time that was filled with much conflict, those that were dealing with the death and devastation of the Civil War, people were dealing with the rise of white supremacy in the United States, and people struggling for fighting for full freedom of inequality of black Americans. Lincoln, a Republican, was in favor of the suffrage, the right to vote, of all freedmen, as well as expanding the rights of African Americans to be the same as white people. But unfortunately, Lincoln got his brains blown out in Ford's Theater by some little Dixie bitch boy that had a small penis and couldn't accept the fact that the North had won, just like every other Dixie bitch on the planet. His vice president, Andrew Johnson, a Democrat and former slave owner, became president after his death, and surprise, surprise, he was not particularly pro-equality with anything, really. Radical Republicans, not radical as in as extreme and they want to blow up people, that was just the name of the group because, I don't know, that's just what people thought was extreme back then? Oh my, the wonders of hindsight and looking back in history. Anyways, these Republicans in Congress wanted to upgrade the rights of black Americans while at the same time, curtailing the rights of former Confederates. Andrew was opposed to things like these, and the 14th Amendment and the Freedmen's Bureau, which Congress were able to pass despite his attempts at a denial. The whole Reconstruction era was pretty much just American Civil War II, Electric Boogaloo. Same sides, too. It was the Republicans who were pro-abolishment and anti-slavery, while Democrats were pro-slavery and anti-abolishment. With the new national laws of Reconstruction, it led to a rise of white supremacy in the United States, and the creation of the rise of the KKK, the Ku Klux Klan, by six former Confederates. It also led to the implementation of Jim Crow laws in the United States, you know, the whole separate but equal bullshit with segregation. And the KKK killed plenty of black people, those who supported and fought for their rights, and so many, so many more. The federal government passed enforcement acts in 1870 and 1871 to help suppress the KKK, one of these being the Civil Rights Act of 1871, and while Jim Crow was still about, the KKK had been successfully squashed into the dirt. For a while. Oh, the days that the government would actually squash terrorist groups instead of relying them on voting power. I'm laughing, but I'm crying on the inside. But just before we get there and finally get to the subject of this video, I want to briefly get back to the Uncle Remus books. I know, it won't take much longer, I promise. A lot of people read them as children, and one of them was a young boy in Hermosa, Chicago. Or was it Missouri? I'm not entirely sure. He was born in Chicago, but spent a lot of his childhood in Missouri, so he probably read it either there. Point being, a young boy read it, and this young boy would go on to co-create one of the most powerful corporations on Earth, and his image would be forever shouted in fame and infamy. Legacy itself is a very mixed one, and Song of the South is a part of the reason why Walt's image is so controversial, to say the least. And Walt's image compared to who he actually was as a person is a whole other can of worms. It's due to, well, a whole bunch of things, really, and this movie is one of the reasons. But before we get to the production side of things for this film, how about we go over Disney as a company up to this point in terms of how they were doing? Well, they weren't doing good at all. They were kind of in the shitter at the moment. In the years leading up to Song of the South, the only two films to turn a profit were Snow White and Dumbo. A good chunk of their lack of turning a profit was due to the Second World War. They couldn't make any money from the European or Asian theaters due to the conflict. In fact, it was because of this lack of profit that led to the 1941 Disney animated strikes, but that's another tale for another day. In fact, Disney wouldn't really turn a profit for an animated film until Cinderella released in 1950. Fucking 4 years after this.
And as if the lack of box office returns wasn't bad enough, the actual critical response to these movies wasn't exactly high either. Fantasia was incredibly mixed, as audiences and critics didn't really know what to make of it, and Bambi was seen as far too somber during the war, as that was a time in trying to boost morale to fight the Axis, which was also the same reason why Billie Holiday's cover of Gloomy Sunday was banned from playing on the BBC radio in Britain. But before this whole mess and running off of the success of Snow White, Walt had begun to negotiate with the Harris estate in 1939 for a possible adaptation of the Uncle Remus / Br'er Rabbit tales. He managed to acquire the rights from the estate for around $10,000, and for reference, that would be around $19,212.52 in 2021. Which, I mean, that doesn't really sound like much given the, monolithic regime that Disney is nowadays.
They're fucking watching us, I swear to Christ. They're gonna fucking kill us one day, I swear to God.
But keep in mind, this was early in the company's history, and this was when Walt was still relatively new to feature-length animation. And boy oh boy, did he have plans for this movie. The film, originally titled Uncle Remus, was supposed to be a fully animated feature, as well as the film being two real animated shorts. One story would be about Br'er Rabbit tricking Br'er Fox into riding him like a horse to a party, another would be about Br'er Bear being terrified of a scared ghost, which in reality was a disguised Br'er Rabbit, and one treatment would have Remus bring the critters to negotiate a peace between the predators and prey in a church. And one more idea was to have Br'er Rabbit's gambling addiction be the catalyst for the film's adventures. As you could tell, Walt had a lot of ideas for this movie, to the point that his brother Roy was getting kind of worried about the production of it and how much it would cost. Down into the film that was, I quote, "big enough in caliber and natural draft to warrant a budget over $1 million and more than 25 minutes of animation." Keep in mind, most of Disney's films up to this point, aside from Snow White and Dumbo, bombed hardcore at the box office, and they didn't have another financial hit until 4 years later. In fact, the more that I read this out loud, and, you know, I'm narrating this little thing, and Jesus, the microphone peaked, I'm gonna have to fix that, the more I realize, this is actually kind of the same reasons that Walt had put off making a Winnie the Pooh movie. He had been wanting to make one since the 1930s after the success of Snow White, but due to certain things, like there not really being much conflict or having much engagement for a full feature film, he put that off until the 1960s. Kind of interesting now that I think about it. There's also another connection to Winnie the Pooh with this, with a certain animator who watched Song of the South as a small child and worked on it in the 1960s. Winnie the Pooh, I mean. But we'll get to that later. To be fair, Roy's fear wasn't exactly unfounded, especially since this film was going to be slightly more experimental than the other previous Disney animated movies. Well, okay, I say animated, but technically it's a mixture of animation and live action, which, to be fair, isn't exactly uncommon or unusual, especially for Disney, given that their early shorts were the Alice comedy shorts, a series of black and white shorts about a live-action little girl named Alice visiting cartoon worlds, vaguely inspired by Alice in Wonderland. There's two stated reasons as to why the film became a live-action animation hybrid rather than a fully animated film. One, budgetary concerns and wanting to expand the company's library in terms of genres of content. Like I said, live-action and animation were a part of Walt's beginnings, and Walt wasn't exactly a stranger to innovating or experimenting with different new genres. Probably one of the most notable that he helped kickstart or really innovate was the nature documentary genre. And reason number two, Walt had said,
"I always felt that Uncle Remus should be played by a living person, as should the young boy to whom Harris's old Negro philosopher relates his vivid stories of the Briar Patch."
In 1944, Walt had hired professional Southern-born writer Dalton Raymond to write the film's screenplay and was in discussion with King Vidor, a film director who was best well known for the black and white sequences in The Wizard of Oz, about directing the live-action segments of the film. Walt had also hired two other people, Clarence Muse and Maurice Raff. Clarence Muse was actually the first black man to appear in a leading film role, 1929's Hearts and Dixie, which was also the first film with an all-black cast.
Wald had hired Clarence to look at the film's screenplay, but he quit after Raymond's refusal to portray the black characters in a much more dignified and less stereotypical style. Hughes had allegedly written to the editors of black publications all across the United States, criticizing the portrayal of the black characters in Raymond's script, to which Disney had allegedly responded by saying that he was just jealous that he didn't get the part of Uncle Remus. Now, I say allegedly because there seems to be a little bit of conflicting info about this. This information about Clarence Muse comes from two sources that I've seen, one being the book, Who's Afraid of Song of the South, and other Forbidden Disney Stories by Jim Corcus, a Disney historian that has had some allegations of plagiarism, at least according to this random WordPress website that I found when looking for information. And looking at it, yeah, there does seem to be a little bit of plagiarism on his part, and, you know, you could ask, what the heck does this have to do with the Clarence Muse story? Well, it kind of questions his credibility a bit. You know, did this actually happen? I'm not saying that it didn't happen, because it very well could have, but there's a couple things that kind of make me scratch my head a bit. The other was from an article on Mouse Planet, a website, which did state that Wald had offered Clarence Muse the role of Uncle Remus, but he turned it down as it would be, quote, detrimental to the cultural advancement of the Negro people. However, it's very difficult to find sources on this, mainly newspaper screen grabs of what's being said, as Muse had allegedly sent this out to different publications, primarily black-owned publications across the United States. Apparently, Wald had actually offered the roles of Uncle Remus to numerous different actors who either left the project or turned it down, but it also confuses me a bit because Clarence later returned to Walt Disney's show The Swamp Fox on TV. And that kind of confuses me a bit, because if you had difficulty working with a company in the past, especially with working with those who wouldn't cooperate you, and find what they did detrimental to the cultural advancement of an entire group of people, then why return to said company? I mean, you know, you can argue desperation since, well, he was a black man in America in the 1950s, and work, especially on the newly booming television, was very, very difficult to come by. But given Muse's description in the book and his pretty understandably fiery conviction about this, it doesn't add up, or there's not really a solid answer. Maybe Muse and Walt had later patched things on. It's really difficult to tell with this one. Again, I'm not saying it didn't happen, it's just, it's not as open and shut. Based on the info I found, at least. Maybe I'm missing something. Especially given the reason why Wald had hired Muse and Raff in the first place. Wald had feared Raymond's drafts would be racially insensitive, given that Raymond had never written a film screenplay before, and with what Wald described as his southern white slant. This little tidbit of info has been corroborated in several other books, so at least there's more confirmation about this. According to Jim Corcus's book, Raymond's draft included the phrase like Massa for the white characters and Darky for the black characters, and that they actually were slaves, meaning that this draft of the film took place during the Civil War in times of slavery, which is even more fucked up when you consider the fact that Uncle Remus was a former slave and it was meant to take place after the war, which kind of contradicts the original intent of the tales and Joel Chandler Harris himself. It's I should probably mention this little tidbit of info too, as despite some articles claiming this, no, the film doesn't take place during or before the Civil War. Both the Walt Disney Company and RKO pamphlets for the film state that the film takes place in 1870, 5 years after the end of the Civil War and slavery in the United States was abolished. However, the film doesn't make it clearer on that, and the sharecropper's freedom in the movie is pretty ambiguous, coming across as very carefree and happy, when in reality, no, it was anything but, even after the war ended, and many, many more decades to come. Not to mention the fact that the film is set on an old plantation, it's very, very easy to understand why this looks like Uncle Ruckus's wet dream. I mean, hell, this all could have been avoided if Disney listened to the Hayes office, as they asked him to put a disclaimer saying that the film takes place in 1870. But then again, Walt and Disney as a company were often regarded as status quo challengers, and the Hayes office enacted such strict guidelines on film that anything seen as possibly risque was snuffed out. So maybe Walt had it in his mind that it was censorship? I don't know, he got those complaints when he was working on Pinocchio and Bambi, so it's entirely possible. Maybe he just equated everything the Hayes office said was just them trying to censor him, or something like that. It's kind of hard to tell. Raff himself not only removed the offending phrases, but also added dialogue to make it clear that the sharecroppers seen in the movie were freed slaves. Although, for whatever reason, that dialogue didn't make it into the film. One example being a character saying, "We gotta pay these people, they're not slaves," in reference to the sharecroppers, and in another scene where Remus is told that he can't read to Johnny anymore, he says, "I'm a freed man, I don't gotta take this." Raff was very, very hesitant to touch the movie, but it was a combo of him having the ability to make changes to Raymond's draft and Walt's encouragement. Some specifically cite Raff's political and personal views, as he was a Jewish man and an outspoken left-winger, who saw the br'erbbit stories as metaphors for the enslaved Africans as a way to get back at their racist white owners. He specifically feared the film was going to be Uncle Tomish, and Walt himself said to him,
"That's why I want you to do it, because I know that you don't think I should make the movie. You're against Uncle Tomism and a radical."
This paints Walt in a new light that I'd never really seen him in before. Remember how I talked about that story of Clarence Muse confusing me? This is why. If Walt only thought that Muse was jealous, then why would he even hire him, or Raff for that matter, in the first place? If Walt was the man that a lot of people, and I thought he was for the longest time, why would he even consider or even fear about the film being seen as offensive and racist? Learning this little tidbit of info actually kind of gave me a better insight into Walt and who he was as a person. He's usually hyped up to either be the savior and innovator of entertainment, or demonized to be this vile, repulsive, bigoted, crotchety old man.
"Welcome back, Mr. Disney.
Are the Jews gone yet?"
No.
"Put me back in."
Looking at this, though, I don't really think it's one way or the other now. Raff had worked on the film for about 7 months, and at this time it was still titled Uncle Remus. But he left the project after personal disputes with Raymond. A new writer was brought on by the name of Morton Grant. Raff had said that Walt ended every meeting with, "Well, we've really licked it now." And then the next morning he'd called saying that he had a new idea. According to Raff, some were good, some were bad, but Walt couldn't really be fully satisfied. Walt had supposedly sent the scripts for comments both within and outside the studio. And it was around this point that the movie was changed from Uncle Remus to Song of the South. And remember how I mentioned Walt had asked actors for the roles of Remus? Well, he did ask one particular actor, Paul Robeson. Robeson? Robeson, not Robin. I'm sorry. He had asked Mr. Robeson all the way back in 1941. And while the two kept in touch about the project, Robeson was ultimately decided too controversial for his political views. Wait, what? That seems really silly. That seems really silly considering Walt had hired a very political man to help balance out the bigotry of one of his writers. I mean, maybe it's the times viewing things that aren't really that political as political. Like how labor unions were seen as communists. Let's see, he was for unemployment benefits, anti-imperialism, anti-fascism, and pro-civil rights. Yeah, it doesn't really seem that controversial at all, really. In fact, he seems pretty ahead for the time. Wait, what the fuck is this? He was sympathetic towards the Soviet Union and communism? What the fuck? Jesus! Oh, Lord. I mean, maybe he didn't know how bad that was. It actually was. I mean, commies are just as good as hiding info as they are starving people and committing horrible genocides that, get locked up for several decades, so who knows? Jesus. Actor James Baskett originally auditioned for the role of a butterfly, with him saying, "I thought that maybe they tried me out to furnish the voice for one of Uncle Remus's animals." Upon hearing his voice, Walt was so impressed that he met up with Baskett and had tested him out for the role of Uncle Remus. for which not only he was given the role of him, but also the voice of Br'er Fox for the film's animated segments. For the three animated segments of the film, based on Uncle Remus' tales of course, there were the characters of br'errabbit, br'erfox, and br'erbear. In addition to br'erfox being voiced by Basket as mentioned earlier, br'errabbit was voiced by singer and actor Johnny Lee, and br'erbear was voiced by actor Nick Stewart. Though, in the third segment, Johnny Lee was on tour promoting the film in Europe, so they had James Basket voice br'errabbit in the Laughing Place segment. And, well, personally for me, I think it shows Basket's vocals and acting range of not only being able to play Uncle Remus and Br'er Fox, but also being able to sound pretty damn close to Johnny Lee's br'errabbit voice in the Laughing Place segment, especially when you compare the voice to the other two segments.
You mean leaving for good?
That, ow! Now see that? That old brow patch ain't brought me nothing but trouble. Ow! And more trouble.
What's the matter with you? I said howdy. Is you hard of hearing? I said howdy! Look, if you don't say howdy time I count three, I'm gonna bust you wide open.
That's terrible.
Huh?
That's just a secret place I knows about. Well, now how can I show you where it is when I was all tied up like this?
It's actually pretty perfectly seamless, and it's kind of sad that Basket doesn't really get much recognition in the world of either acting or voice acting for his ability to seamlessly switch between these roles. Not to mention that his own quick delivery of Br'er Fox's voice was so fucking fast that the animators actually had trouble lip-syncing the dialogue to him. And, you know, the same goes for Stewart and Lee. You know, Stewart, I would say, gives Br'er Bear sort of a voice similar to a large child, you know, where, you know, they're both very quick to certain emotions like anger and excitement. And Lee gives br'errabbit a bit of a smart aleck voice, but more on the side of something like a lovable prankster versus, I guess, like, you know, a Bugs Bunny, "Yeah, what's up, Doc?" sort of thing. It's kind of like if you gave Jerry from Tom and Jerry the ability to speak.
You said it. I didn't.
Well, okay, if you gave him the ability to speak and it completely didn't destroy the whole point of the character, but you get my point.
Now,
Though I should mention, this actually wasn't the first time Basket or Stewart voiced in a Disney film. Oh, no, 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 no. In fact, they voiced characters in another one of Disney's most famous films. They voiced the crows from Dumbo. Oh boy. Great. Another complicated and controversial piece of not only Disney history, but American animation history as well. Look, the whole thing with the crows and actually quite a lot of Disney stuff is way too complicated. It's kind of a whole other can of worms, especially with the time that I have right now. Ugh. What's the film about? Well, it's about a 7-year-old boy named Johnny going on vacation at his grandma's old plantation in Georgia, which I think is pretty much meant to be a clear reference to Joel Chandler Harris. In fact, I kind of believe that Johnny was written to be a Harris surrogate in some aspects, but as it turns out, his parents are separating from each other during this time. As well as mom and grandma stay at the plantation, his dad returns to Atlanta. And here's a little interesting fact. The actors who played Johnny's parents were actually married in real life, but later got divorced. Huh. Well, life imitates art in the weirdest ways possible, I suppose. Johnny is played by Bobby Driscoll, making his very first debut in this film, and later on becoming not only the voice of Peter Pan, but also becoming one of the, I suppose, earliest cases of child celebrities ending in tragedy. Well, at least for the Disney company. That's another story for another day and another mark to add to the mouse's body count. Johnny tries to run away after hearing about this and runs into a group of black sharecroppers telling stories and singing songs, which I gotta admit, they're pretty goddamn catchy. Like, out of all the things in this movie that people have the problem with, one of the things that I've heard consistently brought back as a positive, even for people who find this movie offensive, is the music, because goddamn, it is really catchy. And as Johnny runs away, black sharecroppers get word of what's going on and try to look for him as well. And Johnny eventually runs into an elderly man by the name of Uncle Remus, who befriends him and gives him food as they walk to his cabin. With Johnny wanting to run away, Remus says, and thus, Remus begins to tell Johnny the story of A Dollar a Minute. The way he transitions into the animated world is through the song. Which helped Disney win an Academy Award for Best Original Song for this movie. In fact, Zip-Dee-Doo-Dah kind of became the national anthem for a lot of Disney cartoons, with several shorts with characters like Donald Duck singing it. Zip-Dee-Doo-Dah, Zip-Dee-Dah, my oh my, what a wonderful day.
get the ocean chains out of my way and die. Yum, yum.
There have been several covers across Disney shows and films, and even some musicians like Louis Armstrong and the Jackson 5 have made their own covers of them. It's very much an earworm and very, very difficult to get out of your head once you hear it. And also a little interesting fact, on the final day of shooting, director of animation, Wilfred Jackson, had learned that the Zippity-Doo-Dah segment hadn't been properly blocked out. We all sat there in a circle with the dollars one another, and nobody came up with anything. Then Walt suggested that they shoot Basket in close-up, cover up the lights with cardboard, save for a sliver of blue sky behind his head, and then remove the cardboard from the lights when he began singing, so that he would seem to be entering a bright new world of animation. Like Walt's idea for Bambi on Ice, it made for one of the most memorable scenes in the film. Basket had actually won an honorary Academy Award for his performance, making him the first black man to receive an Oscar. Walt himself had actually campaigned for Basket to receive said award, as he worked, quote, almost wholly without direction, and devised most of Remus's personality himself. Walt had actually kept close contact with Basket after the release of Song of the South, and after Basket's death on July 9th, 1948, his widow had written to Walt saying that he had been a friend indeed, and certainly we have in need. Sadly, despite Basket being, you know, the lead actor and the Oscar winner, he was barred from attending the premiere in Atlanta as it was racially segregated at the time. Even worse is that Basket was in poor health during Song of the South's production, with diabetes and having a heart attack after the film's premiere in December of 1946, and his health had only gotten worse and worse until he eventually died, as said before, on July 9th, 1948, at the age of only 44. The tale of Dollar a Minute begins with Br'er Rabbit wanting to leave his home, the Briar Patch, seeking of a place without any trouble. And even though Remus tries to tell him that regardless of where he goes, trouble will follow, Br'er Rabbit is determined to leave. And after parting with Remus, he immediately gets snapped in one of Br'er Fox's traps. Who eagerly runs to catch his hated prey from the lair of Chickapin Hill. As Br'er Rabbit is there trapped, Br'er Bear runs along, and Br'er Rabbit gets the idea to trick Br'er Bear by lying and saying he's being paid a dollar a minute to be a scarecrow in the trap. Br'er Rabbit offers the job to Br'er Bear, to which he happily accepts, as Br'er Fox is coming down to claim his prize. Now, keep in mind, a dollar in 1870 is roughly around 20 bucks and 39 cents today, so Br'er Bear thought he'd actually be getting a fun and easy job with pretty damn good pay. I mean, who the hell can blame him? And keep in mind, this would hypothetically be a dollar a minute. Not hourly, a minute! For a whole day with this wage, he'd roughly get around $29,361.06, and that's only one day! That's not even taking account into a week or month! However, Br'er Fox is infuriated by Br'er, cuts him down, and lets him know that he's been duped, as Br'er Fox is about to get his lights punched out from an infuriated Br'er Bear, to which all three of them get into a classical cartoon dust fight, with Br'er Bear giving Br'er Fox a special preview of the afterlife, thinking he's got Br'er Rabbit, to which Br'er Rabbit runs back off home to the Briar Patch. And that ends the story that's 100% accurate to the book, as that's the only one of the three stories Br'er Bear appears in. The Tar Baby and Laughing Place story only feature Br'er Rabbit and Br'er Fox in the original text. YouTuber Colin Looks Back theorized that the reason why Disney chose Br'er Bear over someone like Br'er Wolf, who was actually the most second common antagonist in the original text behind Br'er Fox and sometimes worked with him, was because Disney already had two wolf characters with the popular Big Bad Wolf from the Three Little Pigs cartoons, and The Wolf in the Peter and the Wolf segment from Make My Music, which came out the same year as Song of the South. Not to mention the company didn't have any bear characters at the time. This is before Baloo or Winnie the Pooh were made into beloved Disney characters and still remained as characters in old texts. Plus, it also could have been for story reasons, since he appears in the first segment and works with Br'er Fox for revenge for being tricked by Br'er Rabbit throughout the other two. Although, even then, he's less of a henchman and more of a calm observer. That is, when he isn't a calm observer. Editorializing a bit here, but watching the three animated segments, honestly, the trio are great. They work wonderfully off each other. I can't exactly remember where, but I think someone described the trio of Br'er characters as Looney Tunes characters in Disney clothing, and it fits. It fits so perfectly. You know, they're really a lot of fun and really well animated, and honestly, I think if they just made the movie the segment of these three, the movie probably wouldn't have been as controversial as it is. So, after being told the story by Remus and taking his advice, Johnny allows Remus to walk him back to his home, forming a strong friendship with the gentle man. And the next day, Johnny makes friends with a young black boy who lives on the plantation named Toby, and have a pretty cute scene involving a frog. It's very charming, I will say. As well as a poor white girl named Ginny, who also lives on the plantation. Ginny gives Johnny a puppy after her two older brothers threaten to drown it. The two brothers here are the live-action surrogates of the animated Fox and Bear, with the larger of the two brothers threatening to knock Johnny and Toby's heads clean off as Br'er Bear does to Br'er Rabbit. Johnny takes the dog home, where his mom refuses to let him keep it for some reason, and the two brothers want the dog back, so he turns to Uncle Remus for advice. Remus is unaware of Johnny's mom's orders about the dog, so he decides to tell Johnny the Tar Baby story. It cuts to a direct adaptation of the controversial story, though more controversial due to the name rather than anything directly within it, as mentioned before. Again, like the Dollar a Minute story, it's introduced with Remus singing a song. This time the catchy How Do You Do, and once again meets Br'er Rabbit in the animated world. After the two part ways, the story pretty much goes how much it did in the original, only with Br'er Bear being present this time and a lot more slapstick and comedy. The Tar Baby made a couple of other appearances in other Disney media outside of comics and storybooks, and actually made a cameo appearance in Toontown and Who Framed Roger Rabbit, along with Br'er Bear in that same movie. It was also in early drafts to appear in the Br'er's most famous outing, but was cut out for the controversy surrounding it. And don't worry, I will talk about that soon because, man, I gotta say, I got quite a lot to say, and it's about that, but also about how genius Splash Mountain as a ride actually is. Like in the original story, Br'er Rabbit uses reverse psychology to trick Br'er Fox and to throw him into the briar patch, only this time with Br'er Bear wanting to knock Br'er Rabbit's head clean off. Johnny then takes Remus's advice and uses reverse psychology to trick the brothers into telling their parents about the dog and wanting to drown it, to which they get their asses rightfully beat. Thank you.
but you ain't gonna get it.
And as an act of petty revenge, the brothers tell Johnny's mom about the dog, and she's very furious about Johnny and Remus for disobeying her orders, and tells Remus to stop telling stories to Johnny. And honestly, watching this, it's really sad. Johnny's clearly going through a lot of shit. I mean, he's a little kid with parents being divorced, his dad's away, and really only has Remus properly trying to give the kid guidance and comfort, and his mom takes away that one vessel of true support the kid has, and she's so needlessly hostile towards Remus.
Oh, Miss Sally, didn't Sis Tempe tell you he was with me?
Yes, she told me, but it's so long past Johnny's bedtime.
To be sure, Miss Sally, I was telling him a tale about Br'er Rabbit, and Plum forgot the time.
Well, I don't mind your telling him stories, Uncle Remus, but you know perfectly well it's too late for him to be
home. Yes, it won't happen again, Miss Sally.
I'm sure.
Johnny didn't mean no harm. He just trying to be like Br'er Rabbit. I told him a tale about the tar baby, and he just got a little bit too bodacious and outreached himself, that's all.
Uncle Remus, I'm trying my best to bring up Johnny to be obedient and truthful. But you and your stories are making that very difficult. I think maybe it would be better if he didn't hear any more for a while.
Well, Miss Sally, the stories ain't done no...
They only confuse him. Now, I know you mean well, Uncle Remus, but Johnny's too young.
Miss Sally.
I'll have to ask you not to tell him any more.
All right, Miss Sally.
No, it's my fault. I should have known you couldn't stop telling your stories. I don't like to say this, Uncle Remus, but from now on, I want you to stay away from Johnny. You understand? Completely away.
I mean, what's his mom even really doing? Why is his dad staying in Atlanta for? I mean, I know the two of them are separating, but neither of them can console or comfort the kid? I mean, they're on vacation and clearly wealthy, at least for his mother, so why can't she be there for her kid? I don't understand. That's probably one part of the movie that makes me go, what the fuck? Well, okay, that's not the only part, but you get what I mean. The next day, it's Johnny's birthday, and as Johnny and Ginny get ready to go to the party, the older brothers push Ginny into the mud, and she runs off crying, and Johnny tries to comfort her, to which the two little shits decide to fucking yell and taunt them, to which Johnny proceeds to start beating the shit out of them. Oh, it's... chef's kiss. The fight is broken up by Remus, which I kind of wish he grabbed the cane and started joining Johnny in the fight, but you know, that is what it is. He just scolds the two brothers and comforts Johnny and Ginny.
I know what. I'll tell you a story about br'er rabbit.
Let me see. About this here br'er rabbit. He was the most bodacious critter in the whole world. Anyway, the critters was all having a big party.
Johnny doesn't really want to go to his party because his father won't be there, and Ginny's upset because her dress is ruined. Remus decides to tell him the story of the Laughing Place, where Br'er Rabbit seems like he's done in for, about to be roasted on open fire in Br'er Fox's lair. To which he decides to start laughing like a maniac in the face of certain death. Br'er Rabbit explains that he's just been to his laughing place, which fills him with so much joy and laughter he just can't contain it. Br'er Fox isn't fooled, but Br'er Bear wants to see it, so he forces both br'ers to show him.
Everybody's got a laughing place, a laughing place to go. Ho, ho.
You better just try to move
it upside down and you'll find your side. Ho, ho.
Br'er Rabbit fools them into going into a bush with a beehive waiting for them, and the villains are chased off by the swarm, to which Br'er Rabbit starts laughing his ass off, keeping his word that it was his laughing place. And also, a little fun fact here, the audio of Br'er Rabbit laughing here was later reused for King Louie's laugh in the Jungle Book, where Baloo starts to tickle him. Cheered up, the three of them return to the plantation and the party, only to witness an angry mother, Johnny's mother to be precise. Having missed the entire party, she's fucking pissed, and she completely misunderstands Remus's actions, saying that she doesn't want him to spend any more time with the kids, to which he sadly packs his things and decides to leave. Like, why is Johnny's mom gonna be such a fucking bitch? Anyways, Johnny runs after him and tries to take a shortcut through a pasture to catch up to him, only to be attacked by a bull and left seriously injured. Back home, Johnny's family, including his father, watch over the young boy as he's between in this world and the next. So yeah, Johnny could likely fucking die. He calls out to Uncle Remus, to which his grandmother escorts Remus into his room. Remus begins to tell the story of the laughing place and Br'er Rabbit, to which he wakes up and is revealed to have survived. I mean, come on, do you think they would be able to do a movie where a little child dies in the 1940s? That would be something if they did go in that direction. Next day, Johnny, Ginny, and Toby are singing Zippity Doodah with the dog following behind them, and Uncle Remus looks on in joy, until he sees Br'er Rabbit and realizes that, oh shit, he's actually real, and decides to drop what he was doing and follow Br'er Rabbit and the kids into the sunset singing Zippity Doodah. The end. Alright, so that's the plot of the film. You notice that I kind of gave more tidbits and about the animated sequences than the live-action ones? Well, it's because outside of Basket's appearances, the live-action segments are pretty boring. Although, I gotta say, despite a lot of, like, controversies with this movie, I will say it's probably the best pre-Roger Rabbit example of mixing live-action and animated cartoons. Like, I think outside of Roger Rabbit, like, before that movie, I think this was the only time where, you know, you can look at a movie with animated and live-action characters and go, huh, that's actually pretty convincing. But yeah, the live-action segments, aside from Basket's acting, is kind of boring. I mean, hell, critics felt the same way, that really only Basket's performances and the animated segments of the movie were only the moments of true Disney magic that popped out. But what else did people have to say about the film? Well, buckle up, buckaroos. Let's get going. I'd like to point out to the main two sides of when the film came out. Those who found it offensive, and those who didn't. Walter Francis Wright, the executive secretary of the NACP, a civil rights organization formed in 1909 to advance justice for black people in the United States, had telegraphed several messages to newspapers about the film, thinking the film depicted an antebellum setting. The antebellum South, if you're not familiar, was a period in history from the late 18th century to 1861, in America when slavery was still around. Now, as I mentioned earlier, the film is meant to take place in 1870. 5 years after the Civil War ended and slavery was abolished. Although, to be fair, given how it's set on an old plantation and very vague about the sharecropper's freedom and how everything is, you know, happy-go-lucky, even though realistically for black people around that time it was fucking agony and horrible and wouldn't get better till, Well, I want to say the 1960s, and even then, today, it's... So it's... Anyways, yeah, it's easy to see how that could be misinterpreted. And he wrote, and I quote, The National Association for the Avowance of Colored People recognizes in Song of the South remarkable artistic merit in the music and in the combination of live actors and the cartoon technique. It regrets, however, that in an effort to neither offend audiences in the North or South, the production helps perpetuate a dangerously glorified picture of slavery, making use of the beautiful Uncle Remus folklore. Song of the South unfortunately gives the impression of an idyllic master-slave relationship, which is a distortion of the facts. While White hadn't seen the film yet himself, his statement was based on memos from two NAACP staff members, Norma Jemison and Hope Spigarn, I hope I pronounced that correctly, who saw the film on November 20th, 1946. Jemison had said that the film was, quote, so artistically beautiful that it was difficult to be provoked over the cliches, but he had said that it kept all the cliches of the book. Jim Hill Media gives a reasoning as to why the NAACP believed this film had been a depiction of slavery. It was something that also confused other reviewers, who, from the tone of the film and the type of similar recent Hollywood movies, assumed it must also be set during the time of slavery, unquote. So, in other words, because of similar films being set on a plantation and having a very happy-go-lucky attitude in the Deep South towards slavery being released around the same time, they assumed it was a film about slavery through rose-tinted lenses. Maybe not rose-tinted, but you get what I mean. You know, it's kind of like how if you've seen a generic action movie and there's a bunch of other action films being released around the same time, you'll probably think they'll be just as generic or meshed together as well. It was, very odd and horribly dated genre, to say the least. I don't know, you're never going to see another old plantation movie in the Deep South again. At least not one with a happy-go-lucky attitude, to say the least. Another film in comparison is Gone with the Wind. In fact, Song of the South features one of the actors from Gone with the Wind. Hattie McDaniel is Aunt Tempe. Not only that, but Miss McDaniel even got her own little song. Hattie was actually the first black person to win an Oscar for a role in the Gone with the Wind, which is a film that is extremely controversial, especially nowadays. She played the role of Mammy. Yeah, it's one of those situations. Gone with the Wind is pretty controversial with its depiction of slavery. However, unlike Song of the South, it's regarded as one of the greatest films of all time, and has actually been credited with changing the way black people would be depicted in films. Also, while Song of the South depicted the Reconstruction era, where slavery was abolished, Gone with the Wind depicted the antebellum South Civil War era, meaning it was going from the era of slavery into the American Civil War. Not to mention Gone with the Wind has been released on streaming services and DVD multiple times, but I'll talk about that later. It's getting there. The black press in general was pretty divided on the film. Richard B. Deere of the Afro-American wrote that he was thoroughly disgusted with the film, believing it was, in his own words, as vicious a piece of propaganda for white supremacy as Hollywood ever produced. Meanwhile, Herman Hill of the Pittsburgh Courier felt Song of the South would prove of inestimable goodwill in the furthering of interracial relations, and considered criticism of the film to be unadulterated hogwash, symptomatic of the unfortunate racial neurosis that seemed to be gripping so many of our humorless brethren these days. During production, there was some talk of the br'er characters to be in a series of animated shorts, but after the film's controversial release, they decided to opt out on that. However, they would continue to appear in a lot of Disney media, such as comics, advertisements, and of course, the Disney theme parks. There was a comic strip series from 1945 called Uncle Remus and His Tales of br'errabbit meant to promote the film, but ended up running until about 1972. With plenty of new characters and eventually merging over continuity with the Big Bad Wolf comics, as they were extremely popular and started around the same time, with even more comics featuring the characters that were made from the 1940s to about 2012 or so, and usually the most popular comics were in the Netherlands. They actually seem to fit perfectly within that part of the multiverse, you know, the Disney multiverse. Although, the trio of br'ers did appear outside of those to interact with the heroic Disney characters in various comics and other media. Seriously, you'd see br'errabbit, you know, no surprise there, but also br'erfox and br'erbear interact with Mickey and Minnie a lot back in the day, with the Disney staff using br'erbear getting the most out of the, well, entire br'er trio. It's kind of weird seeing br'erbear and br'erfox interact with the heroic Disney characters considering they wanted to fucking skin and kill br'errabbit. But, you know, they're more comedic villains like Captain Hook, and he's also shown up with them a couple times, so I guess it makes some sense why you'd see them there. Their comics are actually a really lot of fun to read, as you get to see a lot more of the characters' antics and more of their world. In particular, Br'er Bear is actually given the most sympathetic moments out of the trio in the comics, as while he's a bit grumpy and dumb like in the animated segments, he's a generally hard-working farmer with a wife and kids that he loves a lot. Essentially, think of Golden Age Homer Simpson, but instead of strangling Bart, he wants to lop off Br'er Rabbit's head clean off. Hell, he's really the only one to consistently have a family in the comics, even though in the original Uncle Remus stories also depict Br'er Rabbit and Br'er Fox as being married and having kids. And while those have popped up sparsely in printed media, Br'er Bear is the only one consistent with that in the Disney comics. Two really odd stories I found were one of Br'er Fox and Br'er Bear trying to catch Chip and Dale and Bambi to sell off to a zoo, which is, that's just bizarre. And another one was where Pluto gets separated from Mickey and his nephews, in which he is pursued by the two br'ers mentioned earlier, to catch him to sell him to a farmer for money or even sell him for a meal. And Pluto in the story is helped by the crows from Dumbo. Oh boy. Golly gee willikers. It's like all of the controversies are coming on for a crossover. Alright, where's the blackface centaurs from Fantasia? Or how about the Siamese cats from Lady and the Tramp? Or all the racist caricatures of Japanese people from Disney's wartime cartoons? Hell, get the natives from Peter Pan in there. Hell, why stop at Disney? Get fucking Bosco. Get, like, Coal Black and the Seven Dwarves. Get Mammy from the Tom and Jerry cartoons. Why fucking stop at one? Get them all! Get them fucking all! In the theme parks, they've been meetable characters since at least the 1960s, and were seen a lot in the New Orleans Square area when that opened, as well as in various promotion for that area. Well, okay, at least Br'er Fox and Br'er Bear were. Br'er Rabbit's costume seemed to be pretty underutilized by the company, as there weren't many photos or videos of this costume during this time period. Though the ones that do exist kind of make him look like a weird, like, I don't know what other way to say it. He just looks like a whitewashed Thumper. Like, it looks like they tried to whitewash him and turn him into Thumper. That's the only way I can describe it. There's no other way I can put it into words. A newer, more accurate costume of Br'er Rabbit started appearing around the same time the Splash Mountain ride opened up. They even made an appearance on a record celebrating Mickey Mouse's birthday in 1954, with Johnny Lee and Nick Stewart returning the roles of Br'er Rabbit and Br'er Bear. However, considering James Baskett had sadly been dead for 6 years, Stan Freberg, best known for voicing several Looney Tunes characters, voiced Br'er Fox on this record.
Just wait till old Br'er Rabbit comes along this road. Just you wait, Br'er Bear.
What'll happen then, Br'er Fox?
What'll happen? Yeah, that's easy, Br'er Bear. When old Br'er Rabbit comes along, he step in this glue I got spread all over the road, and he'll be stuck fast. Yes, sir. Our Br'er Rabbit's shoes be stuck so fast in the glue that he won't be able to move.
When he gets stuck, I'm just gonna knock his head clean.
Oh, no, you ain't. No, you ain't, Br'er Bear. When he gets stuck in the glue, I'm gonna grab him and eat him. Yes, sir. I'm gonna eat him. Shh. Wait a moment. Better get behind these bushes and lay low, 'cause here comes old Br'er Rabbit now.
Yeah.
Oh, happy day, I walk along with nothing more than a whistle and a song. But I am happy just the same, 'cause I like being me. Br'er Rabbit is the name. Hey, my feet stuck. I can't move.
Now I got you where I want you, Br'er Rabbit. Your shoes are stuck in the glue, and I'm gonna grab you and eat you.
Uh-oh. Seems as our eye's in trouble. But there's more to me than just my shoes. So I unties them quick and... There. Now it's out of my shoes and I can run away. Bye-bye, Brother Fox and Brother Bear. Bye-bye.
He got away. And it's all your fault, Brother Fox. So I'm just gonna knock your head clean.
Oh! No, no! You keep with me, Brother Bear. No, let me be.
The trio's most famous and most well-known appearances would have to be at two attractions at the Disney theme parks. First is the Mickey Mouse Revue, an opening day attraction at Walt Disney World, and a celebration of some of Disney's most famous songs at that point. The trio of br'errs led the band in a performance of Zippity Doodah. However, their biggest outing at the parks is Splash Mountain, which, I gotta say, right, kind of, I suppose, what's the word, editorializing here for a minute? I want to say how fucking brilliant this thing is set up. So, let me explain, right? So, this ride comes about when Imagineer Tony Baxter was trying to think of a way of getting people to the often deserted Bear Country section of Disneyland, make a log flume ride, and make use of the former attraction America Sings animatronics, all while in a traffic jam on his way to work. And once he thought of Song of the South, he got the okay to do the ride and even worked with Mark Davis's widow. Mark Davis, if you're not familiar, was an animator on Song of the South, as well as other famous Disney artists such as Milt Kahl and Bill Pete. Not to mention Mark Davis worked on the Haunted Mansion ride, as well as the America Sings ride. In fact, the designs of the America Sings animatronics were designed by Davis himself, and that made the transition extremely smooth. Oh, and also another fact, some of the animatronics in America Sings and by consequence Splash Mountain, particularly the Fox ones, are based on concept art of a canceled Disney movie called Chanticleer in the 1960s. Pretty cool stuff. The way the ride is set up is to be an adaptation of all three animated segments meshed so beautifully together. You know, it's a log flume ride with you following on and being Br'er Rabbit on his journey for adventure, outwitting Br'er Fox's and Br'er Bear's attempts to catch him. He lets Br'er Bear get trapped in a snare like in Dollar a Minute. Br'er Rabbit then goes on to find his laughing place with the other two following him. As such, Br'er Rabbit leads them to a cavern full of bees and starts laughing his ass off at Br'er Bear getting stung in the laughing place story. And Br'er Fox catches Br'er Rabbit in a beehive and, like the Tar Baby story, Br'er Rabbit uses reverse psychology to trick Br'er Fox into throwing him into the briar patch, at which point the log flume would experience its signature drop, giving you the same feeling you were being tossed into the briar patch like Br'er Rabbit. Except this time, all three of the br'ers falling, with Br'er Rabbit reuniting with his friends, and Br'er Fox and Br'er Bear stuck in the thorns, and Br'er Fox getting his tail tugged at and bit on by Br'er Gator, as the Gators are all friendly to all the other critters in the ride, except for them. It's one of Disney's, honestly, most genius and clever rides I think I've ever seen. Granted, I don't really go much on amusement park rides because I'm worried that they're always going to break down, but you know, I can appreciate for how clever it is and how well it blends the sequences together. The narrator of these rides are Br'er Frog, a character that briefly appeared in Song of the South. They changed the narrator from Uncle Remus to Br'er Frog at the request of Michael Eisner, which, I gotta say, it's probably one of his better decisions that he made, you know, at least before he went loco. Still, even though the Uncle Remus isn't in the ride, several of the quotes that he said in Song of the South are still written on there, at least at the recording of this video. Speaking of, if you've seen the Defunctland episode on the Tales of the Okie Finokie Dark Ride at Six Flags Georgia, a ride loosely based on the Uncle Remus stories and influenced by Song of the South, and it itself actually being an inspiration for Splash Mountain, you no doubt have seen Splash Mountain's bizarre advertising.
Well, you know it is a thrill when you go downhill, cause you're riding on the mountain of your own free will, and you're zipping in a flash on a daring dash down a waterfall so rapid that you go splish splash.
Splash Mountain,
zippity-doo-dah.
Splash Mountain,
zippity-ay.
Man, I kind of wish that we had this stupidly enjoyable entertainment back when it comes to advertising. Now everything's just kind of boring and the same, without the same, like, sappy ukulele music or, like, the dark, deep piano. But anyways, here's also a clip from the opening ceremony of the Splash Mountain ride, where the ride has no water, and it's up to Br'er Bear to fix it.
Where are you fellas going in such a hurry?
We's leaving!
Use what?
We's leaving!
Well, what do you want to do that for?
Why, you can't open a Splash Mountain when that mountain ain't got no water!
No water!
No water!
No water!
Hey, everybody, here's Br'er Bear. Maybe he can help us.
Listen to me, Br'er Bear. We're in a peck of trouble. You got to help us. You got to get up there and make that water come rushing down that flume. So go on up there, Br'er Bear, and save the day!
Watch this.
We'll open the steepest, wettest, most splash-tacular place in the whole world!
1, 2, 3, Splash Mountain! Zippity-doo-dah! Wonderful, wonderful day!
But despite what you might think, and what Disney would like you to think, Song of the South has actually had a lot more direct connections to the Walt Disney Company prior to the theme parks. Disney did re-release the film theatrically quite a couple times over the years. In 1956, for the 10th anniversary of the film, and again in 1972 for the 50th anniversary of the Walt Disney Company, and again in 1973, the following year, as a double bill for the Aristocrats, in 1980 for the 100th anniversary of Harris's work, and finally in 1986 for the film's 40th anniversary and to promote the upcoming Splash Mountain ride. It was also played uncut on TV in Europe and on Asian television until about 2006. Another version of the film actually aired on U.S. television on Disney Channel's Lunchbox program from the 1980s till about 2001. This version is notable in cutting out the Tar Baby segment. Now, let's talk about the film itself. I mean, we already did, but in a different way. Disney, for some reason, has been hesitant to re-release it. I'll explain why this is a very confusing decision. During his tenure, Michael Eisner didn't want to re-release it due to not wanting to add a disclaimer and accusations of racism. The following CEO, Bob Iger, said that the film was, quote, antiquated and, quote, fairly offensive. His opinion didn't really seem to change much with the release of Disney Plus, as before he left the company, he said that it wouldn't be released, even without a disclaimer, because the film is, quote, not appropriate in today's world. So, why is this a confusing decision? Simple. Disney has pretty much re-released all of their other cartoons that are racially insensitive and racist, but for some reason exclude Song of the South, and that is troubling. I mean, Dumbo's on Disney Plus with a disclaimer as well, with the racially insensitive crows being there all in all. Though they were originally going to be cut out, but Disney changed their mind after the backlash to that announcement. So, that begs the question, why was there backlash? Well, I mean, I could be a cunt and think everyone that wanted the crows to be in Dumbo are all racist, and, I mean, you could definitely argue there's certainly a group of people that probably were like that. It ain't all of it, or hell, even a majority of it. The main things were, one, the crows are integral to Dumbo's plot and character arc, as they're the ones who help Dumbo realize he can fly with the magic feather. And two, a lot of people, myself included, saw it as Disney hiding their sins. You know, rather than talking about these things honestly and trying to learn from them, they'd rather scrub it under the rug and not address it, what it was, or why it was wrong. And that's really dangerous, because censorship is a very, very slippery slope. You know, if we do not talk about these things, we won't really learn from them or grow as people. Plus, it makes no fucking sense when they re-release all their other cartoons that are racist towards a whole host of minorities, including, but not limited to, black people, natives, Asians, and so many more. You know, it doesn't really make much sense to re-release all those with a disclaimer and talking about them, but not Song of the South. Especially one Mickey Mouse cartoon in particular called Mickey's Melodrummer, which had him and Minnie Mouse and a bunch of his other friends in a blackface minstrel show of Uncle Tom's Cabin. And you want to know the crazy thing is? That short was re-released on DVD in 2004! You see, it all comes full circle. I mean, really, think about it. Think about this genuinely, right? They will re-release a cartoon, their own fucking mascot that they fucked over U.S. copyright law for, in a blackface minstrel show, but not Song of the South. Kind of hypocritical, don't you think? You know, maybe just a slight hypocritical cocksucker. Aside from a few re-releases on VHS and Laserdisc in Europe and Asiatic countries in the 1980s and early 90s, there really hasn't been anything. Aside from a fan restoration, which I've been getting the high quality footage from, and I will leave a link in the description down below, because people need to learn. Also, fun fact, this movie is technically a public domain under Japanese copyright law. Whether it will become public domain under U.S. copyright law, I don't know. Disney seems to want to distance themselves from this movie, but, you know, they're kind of like an abusive partner. You know, they still want to have some level of control. You know, classic authoritarianism, of course. So, okay. Disney doesn't want to re-release the film and is pretty nonsensical and hypocritical with it. Even though other companies have done that with their own controversial films, like the absolute fucking chads at Warner Brothers and HBO Max. In fact, as of June of 2020, last I checked, HBO Max pulled Gone with the Wind from their service due to events that were taking place during that time. But they later put it back up with video explaining the stereotypes and why they're wrong, like absolute fucking chads and champions. Now, you see, that's how you fucking do it. Take notes, people. So, okay, Disney may be just nonsensical and hypocritical with its decisions, but maybe it's just, you know, misguided good intentions. You know, maybe they're trying to help black people and other minority groups, and they just don't know how to properly do it. So, you know, what has Disney done in recent years to help? Well, everything to hinder them, actually. So, the Star Wars trilogy from a couple years back. Now, look, I haven't seen a single Star Wars movie, and honest to God, I don't think I ever will now. You know, especially since for discussion of that recent trilogy, it's just become a bunch of fucking autistic political screeching from neckbeards who collect Funko Pops or believe that the South will rise again. It won't, you fucking Dixie bitch boys. It will never rise again. Give up, cope, seethe, mauled, etc. And screeching dyed-haired people about fucking trivial politics for some inconceivable fucking reason all across the political aisle. I do not understand why fucking Star Wars is, like, now a discussion for politics. And this isn't even just, like, a particular side. It's just, like, it's a fucking movie that's owned by Disney now. There's, like, nothing. There's nothing. Any, like, message you could pull out of it is just, like, doesn't... It's Disney. Like, they don't care. They just want to make money. But anyways, I do know that one of the main characters was pushed heavily, and the character's name is Flynn, played by John Boyega, who I don't know if you can tell, but maybe, just maybe, has a little bit of melanin. You know, it takes years of research to properly understand the complexities of such difficulties. In recent years, there's also been a lot of interaction between China and the United States, whether it be right-wingers criticizing the Chinese government for all of its shitty actions but ignoring the U.S. government's own shitty actions, or left-wingers criticizing the U.S. government for all of its shitty actions but also ignoring the Chinese government's shitty actions. And given China's economy is the second largest behind the U.S., it's no surprise a lot of American companies with no moral values and greed in their eyes want a piece of that, that authoritarian pie. But because China's practically an authoritarian state, the government only allows for certain things. So, while Disney promotes a character like Flynn of the West, they fucking shrink him down on the poster, even though he's a fucking main character. I mean, for Christ's sake, he has a lightsaber. I haven't seen the film, and I can tell, okay, yeah, this guy is pretty fucking important to the movie based on the goddamn poster. So, why did Disney do this? Simple. The Chinese government is extremely racist towards black people. Like, Chinese businesses will straight up refuse service to you if you're black, and will be extremely discriminatory and racist towards you. Like, it's on the same level as Jim Crow America, or I guess Bible Belt America if we're being more specific and accurate to the time period of now, or apartheid Africa. You know, so Disney wants to be, you know, the big progressive company and wave John Boyega around like a shiny little token in the U.S., but throw him away in the dumpster for the Chinese release solely because of his skin color. I don't know about you, but I consider that, maybe just a tiny bit fucking racist! They did a similar thing for Black Panther's Chinese release with a very fucking shitty Photoshop job covering up the late Chadwick Boseman's face. And it's extremely noticeable too, because in every other release of Black Panther's poster across the world, you see a good chunk of the cast who are all black, while in the Chinese release you only see Black Panther and his face covered up by his mask. God only knows how the fucking Chinese audience reacted upon seeing that, considering Black Panther is an all-black cast movie. God only knows, the fucking... Oh man, the reactions would be certainly something else, to say the least. John Boyega himself was pretty silent on it for a time, but he finally came out in an interview in 2020 about Disney, talking about how Flynn was sidelined, saying, "What I would say to Disney is, do not bring out a black character, market them to be much more important in the franchise than they are, and then have them pushed to the side. It's not good. I'll say it straight up." Now, originally when I wrote this part of the script, I complimented him quite a bit on it, because I feel like Disney probably has, like, you know the Nintendo Ninjas? I feel like Disney has that, but instead of the Nintendo Ninjas, they're more like the fucking Gestapo. But, you know, now that I've actually looked at how much Star Wars the guy actually did, I now kind of think he was virtue signaling about it, and just kind of pretending to be outraged. I mean, think about it. I think anyone with, like, a sense of morality would have, I think, walked away from the characters in the film as soon as they shrunk them on the poster like that. Like, it's pretty fucking clear of just, like, what they were doing for that Chinese poster. It's very clear. You know, I think at any point I mean, I could be wrong. Maybe he had a contract. Maybe he had something like that. But if he didn't, I think he could have just walked away or just said no if he really gave a shit. I mean, yeah, one could say, but it's Star Wars. He'd be giving up a lot of financial opportunities. And yeah, he would have, but I mean, he would have had a moral integrity, a backbone, you know, actual ethics, if he just said no. However, I do recognize that the main problem here is Disney and shitty companies, you know, doing this shit. People being greedy and just kind of not giving a shit is just the side effect. John Boyega, if he could have walked away, isn't the problem necessarily. More the consequence of that. Not to mention the queer baiting with their very shitty remakes, where a character will be gay in the US release and market it as such, and then do something with the same sex as them, like dancing or huggy, that could be mildly interpreted as homoerotic, but in the Chinese release, no mention of them of being gay is in the marking at all. Why is that? Easy. China's extremely homophobic. You know, I mean, shit, they didn't allow them to legally have sex until, like, I think 1996 or 1997. Clearly, the faggot people are not allowed. And I can say that. I can say that, you straighty fuckers. I can say it. You can't. Ha 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 ha. Straighty fucker. Ha 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 ha. And finally, we get into the real, real, absolute, shitty, most despicable thing that Disney has done within the fucking past, I want to say, like, decade with this, which is kind of funny thinking about it, but, you know, 10 years, it's, we still got, let's see, 8 left to go. So, if Disney does something even shittier than this in the next 8 years, I won't be surprised, but at the same time, I won't be not surprised. But anyways, the whole little enchilada around the Mulan remake. Now, this whole topic kind of spins into a larger topic, and I'm just going to give the short and sweet of it. So, the Chinese government is committing a genocide towards an ethnic group of Muslims called Uyghurs, or Yiggers. I don't know how you pronounce it. I hope it's not Yiggers, because it sounds like another word that, has already been said by PewDiePie in this video. I'm not exaggerating either when I say a genocide. It's a cultural and a literal one. They're being re-educated, aka brainwashed, into throwing anything related to their culture or religion, singing pro-CCP songs, and even some reports of forced vasectomies and taking out their uteruses. Now, one could argue that these reports are exaggerated. You know, mere falsehoods drummed up by journalists to push anti-Chinese sentiment or to drum up clicks. And to that I say, they have literal fucking compounds and concentration camps, you dumbass CCP bootlicker. If even one bit about that is true, it's violated several ethical and international laws. I mean, it violates those laws, but the UN won't do anything about it because they're a bunch of useless cucks and can't agree to the definition of the word genocide. So it's just, shut up if you say it's not a genocide. It is. Fuck you. You're no better than those people that deny the Holocaust or Holodomor or the Great Leap Forward or the Cambodian genocide. Jesus, there's a fucking lot of these. So, Disney got permission from the Chinese government to film near a Uyghur concentration camp for their shitty Mulan remake, and thank said camp in the film's credits. Now, how the fuck everyone just forgot about this genuinely astonishes me. Like, from people who visit Disney parks, and people like that kind of nightmare, you know, that constantly visit Disney parks. Hot take. If you visit a Disney park now with this knowledge in mind, your opinion is invalid. And I mean, like, just the fact that everyone forgot about this at all just kind of astonishes me. Like, for fuck's sake, Twitter. how about you fucking cancel the Walt Disney Company for this shit? I mean, do some fucking good for crying out loud, you psychopathic morons. Fucking Reddit, Tumblr, and 4chan have done more good for the world than you fucking have. That's really fucking sad. I mean, Jesus, you will cancel someone for making an edgy joke or saying a certain word fucking 5 years ago. But you know, you completely ignore companies and people that do really, really shitty things or have committed actual fucking crimes. Like, just, what is wrong with you? What is up with you? What? Do you have a brain? Do you have a stem? Do you have like a frontal lobe? Did you get a lobotomy? Did you get Bite of 87? Like, what the fuck? Okay, alright, I've calmed down now. I needed to get that off of my chest, because that bothered me. So, how in the fuck Disney can claim that re-releasing or acknowledging Song of the South with a disclaimer is somehow a bad idea is completely beyond me. Like, optics, probably optics to keep their image up, but it's like, even then, when you look at all their other shit, it's like, all the other shit that they've done, it seems like just a cakewalk. However, it seems that Disney wants to move far away from Song of the South and completely just disown it, even though they actually kept selling plushies of the Br'er characters as late as 2021. You know, as you may or may not have heard, there are plans to convert the two American Splash Mountain rides into a Princess and the Frog attraction, with Tony Baxter returning as head Imagineer, but was delayed due to COVID. And, you know, editorializing again, I've been kind of doing that for the latter part of this, but, you know, on one hand, I really love Princess and the Frog. You know, it's one of my favorite Disney movies of all time, and one of my favorite animated movies of all time. You know, I really like it. No, it's genuinely amazing. The animation, the characters, the voice acting, like, the music, the fucking music, it's all just, oh god, I fucking love it. I genuinely do love it. But, you know, on the other hand, there's a couple of things. One, Disney is trying to get away with their actions in the past and not properly address or talk about them in an honest way and just hiding it away, treating it like it's some boogeyman. And two, I think it's going to be really hard to top the genius of the design of Splash Mountain. The Princess and the Frog one is supposed to take place after the movie, so I don't know how it will really convert, unless they're just going to change the track layout completely. And you know, while writing this script and recording it, the retheming date is actually going to be scheduled and completed for 2024. And judging from the concept art, it'll be a ride about Tiana, Naveen, and Louie having an adventure in the bayou. No word on whether the Tokyo Disneyland Splash Mountain will be rethemed, but they did have an event called Splash Mountain Max recently, where the water would be dialed up to get guests extra wet to help combat against the recent heat waves in Japan. But, you know, there's one more thing that I have yet to truly discuss. How the Disney staff themselves reacted to the controversy surrounding the film and the film itself after it was released. James Baskett himself had actually commented on the film's response by saying, quote, "I believe that certain groups are doing my race more harm in seeking to create dissension than can ever possibly come out of Song of the South." Nick Stewart, the voice of Br'er Bear, had actually reprised the role of the character for the Disneyland version of the Splash Mountain ride for the very last time in his career before his death in 2000. And according to Jim Corcus in an interview, when asked if he thought that it was demeaning to portray Br'er Bear or be taking part in such a demeaning film, he laughed it off and said Disney treated them like kings. He had said that he used the money from Song of the South to form the Ebony Showcase Theater, which had the goal of helping black stage actors play more roles than just cooks or maids in theater roles, and in fact it had attracted people from various races and ethnicities, with some notable talent including Eartha Kitt, Nick Amos, Phil Collins, and Gladys Knight. He claimed that he would do the same thing with the money he'd get from Song of the South, and fun fact, there actually is the Ebony Showcase Theater website still up, and from the looks of it, run by Nick Stewart's daughter. Another little fun fact, in the Disney World version of Splash Mountain, Br'er Bear was voiced by James Avery, best known as Uncle Phil from The Fresh Prince of Bel-Air, and some of the dialogue of Br'er Bear in the Disneyland version is supplied by Jess Harnell, as well as Nick Stewart's dialogue as previously mentioned. Jess Harnell is the voice of various characters across various cartoons and video games, most notably Wacko Warner, and in relation to this particular case, br'errabbit in various appearances in the Splash Mountain ride and other appearances as well. Avery also voiced br'erfox in the ride, and J.D. Hall supplied the voice of br'erfox for both versions as well. Floyd Norman, Disney's first black animator personally hired by Walt himself, has quite a lot to say about Song of the South, especially since that he saw it as a small child when it premiered. In addition to the numerous films and TV shows he's worked on, he also wrote a couple stories for Disney Christmas Story, a yearly comic strip featuring Disney characters saving Christmas in one form or another. In the 1986 story, he had a story that he illustrated and wrote featuring the Br'ers and Uncle Remus, which was really the only story removed from the re-release of the comics by IDW in 2011. He wrote a very detailed and very long blog post about the whole affair and his own opinions on it, so excuse me and get ready for quite the mouthful. Walt Disney was clearly nervous how Song of the South would be accepted by this particular audience. When the film finally came to an end, the reception was positive overall. Though the motion picture failed to garner glowing reviews, most found the Disney film immensely entertaining. The African-American audience absolutely loved the movie and even requested a second screening of the Disney classic. While Walt Disney can be fairly criticized for his rather naive approach to the post-Civil War South, the old maestro can also be praised for his heartwarming story of a kindly old gentleman helping a young boy through difficult times. Yet, the controversy continues, especially among those with a political or social agenda. The Disney motion picture remains an easy target for those anxious to color the story to fit their own needs. I have to remind people that Song of the South is not a documentary on the American South. I am convinced that this charming film will eventually be made available to all to enjoy, and maybe even argue over. After all, some arguments are worth having. I find the film underrated, in spite of the rather clunky live-action segments in the motion picture. Although, some of the live-action is pretty darn charming in my opinion. I love the relationship Uncle Remus has with the woman of the house. She's a white woman, of course. Clearly, they've known each other for years and are the best of pals. However, the issues of color limit their friendship. I've also loved the scene between Uncle Remus and the cook, played by Academy Award winner Hattie McDaniel. Even an Oscar win failed to change the career of this talented African-American actress. She remained pretty much restricted to the roles of a cook or a servant for the remainder of her career. However, these social issues were never the primary concern of Walt Disney. The old maestro was simply doing what he always did best. Walt was simply telling the story of a special relationship between an old black gentleman and a troubled young boy. The film is charming in its simplicity, and sadly, people tend to read too much into the film. Issues that are simply not there. The Tar Baby being the most notorious example. It was never meant to be a metaphor for black children, yet those with a social agenda often point out this particular story to prove their point. Of course, that's why Walt Disney's Song of the South will continue to remain on the shelf for the near future. It is deep with the regret remains mirrored of in accusations of racism and insensitivity to African Americans. Those who know their Disney history know this is exactly what Walt Disney hoped to avoid. America has yet to come to terms with its racist past, and the Walt Disney Company remains uncomfortable with this marvelous motion picture that still causes me to tear up every time I view it. I suppose one should feel sorry for the Disney Company because this film continues to be a cultural hot potato. So much so that Disney CEO Bob Iger is determined not to release the motion picture on DVD. While I understand the concerns of the company and the social impact they fear, I'm afraid I'll have to disagree with this decision. Cynics may call the film sappy, those with a social or political agenda may call the movie racist. However, if you're a fan of classic Disney storytelling, I guarantee you'll not find a better film. Walt Disney's Song of the South is a remarkable motion picture, and I'll continue to support the wonderful film whenever given the opportunity. I can do this without any hesitation because deep down inside, this is a Walt Disney motion picture I've always loved. And, for all of us animation fans, there's really no need to say this film contains some of the most brilliant Disney character animation ever seen on the big screen. Forgetting history is never a good idea. Walt Disney understood that, and so should the rest of us. Animation historian Leonard Maltin wrote, "What I take away from the movie is the following. Uncle Remus is a warm, good-hearted character who captures the imagination of a lonely little boy who happens to be white. The boy is absolutely colorblind, and the audience relates to him. There is an incredible moment where Uncle Remus takes the boy's hand in his, and there is an insert of the white and black hands clasped together. It's the emotional climax of the movie." Diane Disney Miller, the only biological daughter of Walt Disney, said, "It was a film he really wanted to do. My dad quoted so much from Uncle Remus's logic and philosophy." Clarence Page, columnist for the Chicago Tribune, had said it was one of his favorite movies as a childhood, and hoped to show it to his son one day. "There's a deep African tradition in Song of the South. br'erbbit is an emblematic figure of African folklore, a direct descendant of the trickster who gets by on his wits. Where political correctness gets ridiculous is when corporations trying to avoid a controversy just presume that if something is stereotypical, then African Americans aren't going to like this. There is a diversity of images in the media now that reflect our diversity in real life. We can look at Song of the South with a new awareness and appreciation." And finally, when Whoopi Goldberg was inducted as a Disney legend in 2017, she immediately went on the news and said this, "I'm trying to find a way to get people to start having conversations about bringing Song of the South back, so we can talk about what it was and where it came from and why it came out." So, to finally answer the question I asked at the very beginning of this, is Song of the South racist? Well, I can tell you this. Watch the film for yourself. I could give my opinion on it, but that's the thing. It's just my opinion, not yours or anyone else's. When looking at this film, to me, there's not really a right or wrong answer on whether or not the film is offensive, because it's entirely opinionated, and you know what? That's okay. I mean, listen, right? I ain't here to hold your hand and tell you everything and say it's offensive or it's not offensive, because quite frankly, that's entirely up to you. You know, in theory, I could just paint it with a broad brush, you know, act like that everyone that enjoys the movie is a KKK member or an Uncle Tom, or I could just act like those who find this movie offensive are just overly, like, coddled, goo-goo gaga, easily offended babies. But, you know, that kind of approach isn't smart or thoughtful into looking into this whole situation, really. Now, I've rewritten some of this as to when I originally wrote it, as recently I sat down and watched the film with a friend, like rewatching it for this. So now I'll give a fully updated 2022 opinion on it. But again, don't take my word as law. Watch it for yourselves. You got a brain, use it. So personally for me, I actually find the film pretty charming. You know, with the music, the acting, and the animation all being honestly pretty delightful. However, with the imagery of happy-go-lucky black people on an old plantation with an ambiguous time period, it is completely understandable as to why some would see it as a happy-go-lucky view of slavery in the South. But to be clear, it isn't. It takes place after that, and there's nothing necessarily in the film that is, I guess, overtly racist. I mean, personally for me, I think the main problem is the setting. If you changed it, there probably wouldn't be as much controversy surrounding it. Like, instead of it being an old plantation in the 1870s, have it be, like, set in Harlem, New York in the 1920s or something. And you know, Johnny's like a poor kid trying to cope with his parents' divorce and the economic situation changing with there being, like, an economic slump between 1920 and 1921. And also, with his parents divorcing, his dad could be, like, the main breadwinner, and his mom struggling to find employment. And, you know, like in the final film, he goes to Remus for advice in coping with it. And honestly, I think the blame of this movie perception goes both towards the actual movie and just the sands of time not treating it well. The movie's vague time period and imagery of happy black people on a plantation is already very questionable, but when, you know, you look back on it in a historical sense, right, and you look at it with a lot of other racist depictions of black people and various minorities within the film industry, we already kind of view it in the same way that we did with a lot of other racist depictions of minorities in past movies and cartoons. You know, it kind of meshes together, and we kind of assume that because it's during this time period and set with this particular imagery, it automatically falls in the same category, which, I mean, to be fair, that's understandable. Though, if you look on the Wikipedia page of Song of the South, you see in the See Also section, the only article listed in that is the Lost Cause of the Confederacy, which was a racist myth that the Confederacy were heroes and that the slaves were happy and grateful. And you know, look, even as someone who finds the live-action segments as imagery to be somewhat, you know, offensive, I don't want to say problematic because that's just kind of a buzzword, but even in that, right, I still consider that description of it to be quite the fucking stretch. Like, it's a big-ass stretch. You know, that's more accurate to Birth of a Nation, which actually was, you know, parroting that stupid myth, but also to The Littlest Rebel, which was a Shirley Temple film where she goes up to Abe Lincoln to ask him to free her Confederate father from prison, and depicts, you know, the slaves as happy and loving slavery and not knowing what the fuck to do after that. You know, it's as if Shirley Temple wasn't already fucked up enough with, like, the pedophilia surrounding it and the child exploitation, but you know, we gotta add racism to the mix too, you know. Go for it, why not? Jesus Christ. Now on to the next question: are the characters of br'errabbit, br'erfox, and br'erbear offensive? Personally, no, not really. I, you know, as I said before with this, the br'ers feel like Looney Tunes characters in Disney skin. You know, some people can make the argument that because of their distinctive, thick, and exaggerated accents, they could be seen as harmful stereotypes, but, you know, if the argument of that hinges solely on the accent, that doesn't really hold up, given how many characters in fiction have exaggerated accents in general. I mean, like, this is silly to think in retrospect now, but I remember there was a period in, like, when The Princess and the Frog itself came out, and people were complaining that, oh, Dr. Facilier is racist somehow. I don't know how, but people thought that Facilier was racist somehow, and I legitimately do not see it. And, you know, it's really kind of silly with the br'er trio and Facilier to be seen as, you know, racist stereotypes of any kind. Especially when you compare them to actual black cartoon stereotypes that are actually harmful. Like, compare those characters to someone like Bosco from the Looney Tunes, you know, who is a character who was based on blackface minstrel shows and in the copyright registration was said to be a little black boy. You know, the br'ers to me don't really have anything offensive to them in their animated segments or their personalities. You know, if you took away the accents, they're still developed characters with personalities that don't really rely on any racial stereotypes, at least none that I can see. You know, they come from African folklore, and to me, you know, as an American, as a proud American, personally for me, I think we should celebrate different folktales and mythologies from all around the world, because I feel America to be a sort of a crock pot when it comes to different cultures and beliefs and religions and such, and I think we should celebrate that. That's what I personally think makes America a good place to live. I'm not going to say it's fantastic, but I think the people and their culture make it great. And yeah, you could make the argument that the Disney variations of them are linked to something controversial, offensive, but by that very same logic, you know, characters like Mickey Mouse, Bugs Bunny, nor Superman should never appear in any media ever again. Yeah, as I mentioned earlier, Mickey Mouse was in blackface in a minstrel show. Bugs Bunny had the wartime cartoon Bugs Bunny Nips the Nips, where he calls Japanese soldiers racial slurs.
Hey, here's yours, bowlegs. Here, one for you, monkey face. That dope shop, there's plenty for all. Hey, slant eyes. Everybody gets one.
Ice cream.
And Superman had a story where Lois Lane asked when she turned black. I know, it's a fucking whole can of worms if he loved her as a black woman. And when he was asked this, Superman took so long to answer that she just said, yeah, fuck this. I'm going back in the machine and turning white. Yeah, I know, that's just a whole other can of worms. The 1970s were a much, much different time. I mean, hell, realistically speaking, if anything, Disney should also remove anything that references Dumbo or Peter Pan in the theme parks, because, you know, they have their own controversial, like, stereotypes attached to them. You know, it's the sort of inconsistent bridge burning. And, you know, here's the thing. It's very easy to just go, this is offensive, this is bad, we should never, ever talk about it. But we have to accept these things that have happened, and they are a thing, because, you know, if we don't, then we aren't really able to learn or observe from them, and we can't really move forward, you know? You want to know why we haven't had any continuous progression? It's because we have people denying real-world historical offense to support their own fucked up beliefs or not deal with the uncomfortability about talking about these things. You know, the people that go off about, oh, this movie was so offensive, Disney locked it up. I have to ask, have they ever actually seen the film for themselves, or do they just go off public perception? And, like, I also have to ask, you know, this question for these people, but also just generally anyone watching this. Should it stay locked up, or should it be available and be used as a teaching tool? If your argument relies on it's offensive, therefore it should be banned, then logistically, we shouldn't be able to talk about literally anything horrible throughout history, right? You know, if we can't have an honest conversation about a couple of goddamn cartoon animals, can we truly have an honest conversation about reality and real-world events and their consequences still felt today? You know, that's sort of the thing I get from Bob Iger's comments and just, like, the whole thing. It's the sort of white savior complex. You know, the sort of, like, belief, I suppose, that kind of comes from, like, oh, minorities need to be protected. They need to be shielded from anything that could be seen as offensive. When, no, minorities are perfectly capable of assessing and understanding what, you know, is or isn't offensive. They are completely fine with this. They are completely fine with understanding it. Hell, a lot of, like, museums that showcase a lot of the racist history through America are, from my observation, predominantly run by black people. And, you know, like, that's the thing. This is wildly going off script, but this is something I kind of want to make a point of before this wraps up, right? Is that there's, I guess within the political sphere, there's two types of racism I've seen that are very prevalent. There's right-wing racism, which is, you know, the belief that, you know, other races and groups aren't, you know, people, that they're animals, that they're criminals, that they're just violent. And, you know the exactly what I'm talking about in that regard. But I think with this controversy, there's what I like to call left-wing racism, which is the belief that minorities are like children that need to be shielded from anything bad. You know, that they're like animal, like they're like a rare animal or like a valuable, priceless object that needs to be constantly protected. And then you have something in the middle where it's, you know, you see them, you see minorities as people because they are people. You know, it's, and I gotta say that whole like idea of minorities being like, you know, needing, if we're needing the white savior to tell them what is or isn't offensive, that it kind of reminds me of the Congo Free State, if you've ever heard of that, where one of the things they hammered in to the Congolese was that, you know, the white man is here to help the uneducated black man. You know, that was the narrative they pushed. You know, it was a narrative of colonialism and racism. And, you know, I kind of, you know what, fuck it, this is gonna be bold, but, you know, I feel like a lot of the things that that lefties say in this regard, and like people who argue that these films should be banned or anything offensive should be banned, their arguments sound like what would happen if a Klansman tried sounding polite. That That's the best way I can put it. Now, the last sort of thing I want to touch upon is the original text offensive, and is the character of Uncle Remus offensive? Now, see, I can't really give my opinion necessarily on that one, at least for the text, because it's extremely touchy and I'm not sure. But I think it's also important to take the intent into effect. I mean, even if it had good intentions, the result could still end up offensive. But as for the movie, within the context of the Song of the South movie, nah, I don't really think he's an Uncle Tom or anything like that. You know, he's just kind of like a wise old man with a lot of heart and humor. You know, actually, come to think of it, he's kind of like Oogway. He's like a black human Oogway. That's the best way I could describe him. You know, he's like an old wise man, but one with a sense of humor and a lot of heart to him. Though, it is worth noting that there was a 2005 br'errabbit animated film that Universal made, which featured an all-black cast, including my man Phil Lamar and Wanda Sykes, with particular influence from hip-hop in the movie soundtrack, and was praised by critics. So, I guess even if the original text is offensive, that doesn't necessarily mean that it just has to be tossed away. In the right hands, you can do a lot of things with it. And also, I wanted to talk about Coonskin, since that movie uses the three br'er characters and mocks several racist black stereotypes and mocks racism in general, but funnily enough, there's also a huge controversy on whether that movie is racist in and of itself. So, you know, rather than bloat this video any further, I don't know how long it'll be, but you never know, I'll just save that one for another time. Maybe I'll talk about that, maybe I won't, but it's kind of a can of worms. And look, all I can say is this. You know, watch the movie for yourself. The VHS copies have been transferred online, and you can find the full film on the internet. The video footage that I got, I will leave in the description down below, which is from an internet archive, which is a fan restoration of the film. You know, I just gave you the facts of the situation, right? With some editorializing. But this is the facts of the production, its reaction, and so on and so forth. You know, I could have missed some stuff or misinterpreted some stuff. You know, I am willing to admit when I'm wrong. And you know what? If I'm wrong about certain things, if I got certain facts mixed up, if I got certain things wrong about it, please let me know. Let me know, because I am a fucking dumbass. You know, I fuck up on a lot of shit, and telling me that when I fuck up is probably the best thing to do. With all the facts and production history that's been laid out, the rest is entirely up to you. You know, don't let my opinion be yours, right? Form your own opinion. If you find the movie not particularly offensive, that's fine. If you find the movie extremely offensive, that's also fine. You are both completely right to have that opinion. But I think regardless of where you stand, it shouldn't be unavailable. It should be completely available to the public for them to view for themselves and use as a teaching tool. Because even if you find it offensive, there is a very powerful thing in using it as a teaching tool to teach future generations the mistakes of the past. Because, you know, I think that's kind of one of the reasons why we haven't been able to truly progress, because people are scared and uncomfortable when it comes to talking about these sort of situations. I think we're terrified at that, and we kind of delude ourselves into thinking that banning and not talking about them is just going to make them go away, or, you know, make the whole thing about them less painful. But no, we have to talk about it. We cannot bury this in the ground, because if we bury this in the ground, if we ignore it, it will just make things worse. Because, like I said, the whole point of the video, I asked, you know, is it racist? But I wasn't leaning towards a certain conclusion when I first started this thing. You know, when I first started making it, I was going to completely expect that the movie was just completely fucking made on, like, ill intentions. You know, was trying to promote this, like, trying to promote white supremacy and racism. This is entirely what I was expecting to read upon it. You know, like, oh, Walt being a racist piece of shit. But I didn't get that. I, honest to God, didn't get what I was expecting. And I got something else. Something else that doesn't have as easy as a resolution to it. You know, I didn't get Walt being racist, but I also didn't get this movie is completely fine, because, well, the imagery is kind of what holds it back. But again, that's just my opinion. And like I said, don't let my opinion be yours. You know, if you agree with me, it's fine. If you disagree with me, it's completely fine as well, because there's no grand opinion on it. Well, okay, there is one. Don't ban it, because like I said, if you ban it, it only makes things worse. So, on that note, I would like to say thank you for watching this. And, well, have a good day, night, afternoon, evening, whatever time it is. Drink plenty of water. Hug the people you love. And I hope your pillows are nice and cold when you go to bed tonight. Avidazin, and goodbye. Zippity-doo-dah, zippity-ay, my own, what a wonderful day. Plenty of sunshine heading my way. Zippity-doo-dah, zippity-ay, Mr. Blue.